how can we compute a contour integral if a branch point is involved? Well, in that case, we will need to avoid the branch cut. In the example in this video, we'll see another complication. The real integral does not have a symmetry, so how are we going to close the contour? We'll see all of that in this video. Want to integrate from 0 to infinity the function square root of x divided by 4 plus x cubed. So, what are we going to do? Our 5 steps. First step, choose f of z and choose the contour. Well, the f of z is kind of obvious. It should be the square root of z divided by 4 plus z cubed. And we see the first complication, a square root of z. So we have to be careful. We will have to choose a branch cut. We will do that when we choose the contour. But for now, we know that the square root of z equals the square root of the norm of z times e to the power I times 1/2 times the argument of z, where the argument of z still has to be specified. Now we are going to try to find the best contour. Well, first of all, we notice that we want to have this in our contour. Then we see that for large norms of z, so for large r, the function will behave like square root of r over r cubed, so as 1 over r to the power 5 over 2. So for large r, our ml estimates will be fine. So we can make arcs like this. Then for small epsilon, our function will behave like square root of epsilon. So for small epsilon, contributions along c epsilon also vanish. So we can safely make integrals along small circles as well. That will be fine too. So how are we going to close now? Well, the first choice which you would try is to close it like this. So along the negative real axis. Well, first choice, but it's completely wrong. And why is that? Well, we have a pole at z equals minus 4. So what you did now is that you put your pole on your contour. And it's a pole of order 3, so that will blow up. So no way, this contour is never going to work. So we'll not try this one. Second try. Okay, want this, want this. Well, let's close it earlier. Like this. Okay, like that. What happens then? Well, then our pole is outside, over there. So our integral will be 0. So that means that our desired integral over here plus our integral of an imaginary axis will be 0. So the only thing which we will achieve is that we express our real integral into another real integral, which we probably won't know as well. So we are only replacing the problem. So this might work if the other integral turns out to be easier, but it's probably not going to work. So let's try something else. So what can we do? Again, this, and now we go a bit further, like over there. Close it like this. Maybe that's going to work. Well, then our singularity is inside, and we have our integral we want. But we get the integral of the negative imaginary axis. So if we parameterize it, we'll give us a z equals I times xi. So we get the square root will be fine in the numerator, but in the denominator we will get something like 4 plus I xi cubed, which is not the same as 4 plus x cubed. Now this might work if this second integral turns out to be completely imaginary or something like that, but it's probably not such a good choice either. Okay, what can we do then? Well, last choice, we can go around completely. So what are we going to do then? We go fully around. So we have our contour consists of a CR, big R, C epsilon, small epsilon. Those integrals will vanish. An L1 and an L2. But wait, are those two cancelling out? L1 goes like this and L1 goes like that, and they're almost at the same height. Well, wait a minute, we also need to put our branch cut somewhere. So we have to connect 0 to the point at infinity. And now we choose our branch cut along the real axis, the red line in the figure. That means that on L1 we are slightly above our branch cut, so our argument will be 0, and below the red line, so on L2, we are slightly below the branch cut, so our argument will be 2 pi. So we choose the argument of z between 0 and 2 pi. Well, for our z cubed, that won't matter. But for a square root of z, remember we define square root of z equals square root of the norm times e to the power I, 1/2 times the argument. So if I take the argument of 0, that's just 0, so I get just the square root of xi above on L1. But below we get an argument of 2 pi, so we get in square root e to the power 1/2 times I times 2 pi, so e to the power pi I, which gives us an additional factor of minus 1. So we get the minus 1 because we go the other way, but we also get one more minus 1 due to the square root. So in the end, we will have the same integral on L2. So that is why this contour is probably going to work. Well, with step 1 done, we have done the hardest work. But still, we have left steps 2, 3, 4, and 5. 2, Poisson residues, 3, parameterizations, 4 ML estimates, and 5, wrap up everything. First, Poisson residues. Well, our FOZ is analytic on an inside C total, except for the pore offset equals minus 4, which is a pore of order 3. So we can apply the theorem of residues, integral C total f z dz equals 2 pi I times the residue at z equals minus 4. Well, it's a pore of order 3, so we know how to compute the residue. We have to take the limit from z to minus 4. We have to multiply the function by z plus 4 cubed. And we have to take of the result a second derivative, and we have to divide by 2 factorial. Well, this multiplication is nice because those factors of z plus 4 cubed are cancelling out. Differentiate z to the power 1/2 twice, so we get 1/2 z to the power minus 1/2, and one more differentiation, minus 1/2 z to the power minus 3 over 2, that's what you see over here. And the 1/2 comes from the 1 over 2 factorial. And then we can just plug in z equals minus 4. We have to be slightly careful because minus 4 cubed equals minus 64. And we have to take the square root of that times minus 1 over 8, which comes from all those factors 1/2 over there. And the square root of minus 1 over 64 equals the square root of the norm of that, so 1 over 8, times e to the power I 1/2 the argument. We chose the argument between 0 and 2 pi. The argument of minus 1 over 64 equals pi. 1/2 of that equals pi over 2. So we have to multiply by e to the power I pi over 2, which is just I. And there we have our final result. Minus 1 over 8 times 1 over 8 from the norm times I equals minus I over 64. End of step 2. Step 3, parameterize. Well, on L1 everything is fine. We can just choose z equals xi, xi running from epsilon to r, and we get our integral epsilon to r square root of xi, because the argument is 0, over 4 plus xi cubed. No problems there. If we go on L2 slightly below at the branch cut, our argument will be 2 pi, so if we set z equals xi, we have to set z equals xi e to the power 2 pi I. Because its argument equals 2 pi I, and xi just real. Well, our xi is running now from r to epsilon, because we're running backwards. But our square root of z will be the square root of xi, it's the same, times e to the power 1/2 times 2 pi I, so e to the power pi I equals minus 1. That gives us a minus square root of xi, and the denominator is the same. So if you reverse the order of the integration boundaries over here, you get the integral from epsilon to r of square root of xi over 4 plus xi cubed d xi, which is exactly the same as the integral along L1. So the integral along L1 f dz and the integral along L2 f dz are the same. Step 4, the ML estimates. Well, we know a theorem for that. We know that the norm of the integral f z dz is smaller or equal than m times L, where L is the length of the curve. Well, that is easy here. That's just 2 pi r for capital R and 2 pi epsilon for the small one, where f of z is bounded by some a maximum m of r. So we have to estimate the norm of f of z. Well, the norm of f of z equals the norm of the square root of z divided by 4 plus z cubed equals norm of the numerator divided by the norm of the denominator. So norm of the numerator is fine, but we have to estimate the norm of the denominator. Well, we can use the triangle inequality, the second one, because we know that norm of a plus b is bigger than the absolute value of norm of a minus norm of b. So we know the 1 over norm of a plus b is smaller or equal than the absolute value of norm of a minus norm of b, and then the absolute value. That's what we do over here. Norm of 4 is of course 4, and norm of z is still r. So what we get is the square root of r divided by the absolute value of 4 minus r cubed. Well, r will be typically very big r cubed will go to infinity, it's bigger than 4. So the absolute value of 4 minus r equals r minus 4, and that's how we find r mr over here. Square root of r divided by r minus 4 cubed. So what happens with our integral in the limit? Well, the absolute value of the integral is smaller or equal than my mr times l. And now what happens if you take r to infinity? Well, you can divide, for example, by r cubed to see what happens if you take the limit. And then you can show that this limit over here equals 0. So that means that the limit r to infinity of the absolute value of our integral equals 0. So that means, conclusion, the integral itself also goes to 0. That's on CR. What happens on C epsilon? Well, actually, almost the same. You again have a circle, so you can make exactly the same estimate. You can make the same estimate up till here, where you replace the r by an epsilon. But now you have the absolute value of 4 minus epsilon. And epsilon is very small, much smaller than 4. So the absolute value of 4 minus epsilon is just 4 minus epsilon. So my f is now bounded by the square root of epsilon divided by 4 minus epsilon cubed, which we will call m epsilon. And then we know the absolute value of the integral is bounded by m epsilon times 2 pi epsilon, the length of the circle over here. And that gives us a 2 pi epsilon times the square root of epsilon, so 2 pi epsilon to the power of 3 over 2 divided by some denominator. But it doesn't matter. If epsilon goes to 0, the denominator goes to 4, so no problems with that. The numerator goes to 0, so the absolute value of the integral goes to 0. So the integral itself goes to 0. Okay, that concludes step 4. Time to wrap up everything in step 5. Our integral, C total, equals 2 pi I times the residue in minus 4. So that equals 2 pi I times minus I over 64 equals pi over 32. Well, this integral consists of 4 parts, the C epsilon, the CR, the L1, and the L2. Well, if we take the limit epsilon to 0 and R to infinity, this residue is not going to change. It's still inside. So the integral C total, taking the limits, is still pi over 32. But what happens in the limit with the all the contours? Well, the C epsilon integral goes to 0, the CR integral goes to 0, and the integral along L1 goes, becomes an integral from 0 to infinity instead of from epsilon to r. And we got this twice because the integrals along L1 and L2 were the same. So we get 2 times integral from 0 to infinity equals pi over 32. So our integral from 0 to infinity divided by 2 of square root of x over 4 plus x cubed equals pi over 64.